Okay, here's part two of the supplementary lecture for Chapter 3, Urban Sociology, West Virginia State University. And we were talking about stereotypes and prejudices. How can we minimize the negative impact of stereotyping, prejudice, and discrimination in cities or really just anywhere? Well, the first thing I want to talk about is called the contact hypothesis. This is the idea that increased contact between members of different groups will reduce prejudice between them. So in other words, what we're saying is that the more exposure you have to people who are different from you, the less your prejudices will be against those people or that group of people. The best example I can think of to illustrate the contact hypothesis, if you've seen the movie Remember the Titans with Denzel Washington, where he is a football coach in the 1960s, he brought together black players and white players who really didn't like each other and had a lot of preconceived notions about each other at the beginning of the season. But by the end of the season, a lot of them were getting along and had forged very strong friendships. So those prejudices were significantly reduced just based on contact alone. Same is true in cities. People from different walks of life, from different racial or ethnic backgrounds, the more contact they have with one another, the less those prejudices seem to be there or exist. Increased contact between people from different groups can lead to a growing recognition that similarities exist between them. So, you know, it's not like, you know, we're all one way, but people in this different group over here are completely different. No, I mean, the more you talk to people who are quote-unquote different from you, the more you realize that you really probably have more things in common than you think. Perceived similarity can also and subsequently generate mutual attraction. So it can go from the lessening of prejudice to even kind of liking people who are in different groups or different from you. Stereotypes can be altered when people encounter sufficient information that's inconsistent with stereotypes. So if you have a preconceived notion of what, you know, people are like in cities, and you're exposed to them enough and you start to see enough information that goes against the negative stereotype that you hold against, you know, people from different countries who live in cities, then those prejudices can be lessened. Increased contact with members of outgroups may take away the illusion that all members of a stereotype group are more alike. The contact hypothesis works the best when hostile groups interacting are roughly equal in social status, are cooperative and interdependent, in other words, they cooperate with each other and they are dependent upon each other in some way or fashion. And also when hostile groups interacting have norms present that favor group equality. And the extended contact hypothesis, this is the suggestion that merely informing people that members of their own group have formed close friendships with people from an outgroup can reduce prejudice. Let me see if I can explain that quickly. So, in other words, if I'm a member of a group and one of my friends goes outside of my group, has a conversation or a relationship with someone in an out-group, and comes back to my group and says, you know what, I know, Brandon, you've never met these people, but they're really not that bad. They're kind of like us. They're really okay. That can reduce my prejudices against people in that group, just hearing that from someone else. So, and that can certainly work in cities as well. Now, attribution. This is the process where we try to determine the causes behind others' behavior. You don't have to be a psychologist or a sociologist to engage in attribution. You probably are constantly trying to figure out why people dress the way they do, say the silly things that they say, date the people that they date. And we're always trying to figure out why people are doing what they do. And certainly, you don't have to look very long and hard into cities to start asking these kinds of questions. And I always like to talk about Walmart. I know this is a little off the topic of urban sociology, but it will bring it back. I've often wondered about people who eat food before they pay for it. I'm not talking about like picking up a grape off the produce stand and eating it. That's definitely not egregious. It's not appropriate, but it's not egregious. But a family who literally sits down in the middle of the aisle and opens up a can of Chef Boyardee and a box of crackers and raisins, and they just sit there and eat it right in the floor without paying for it, you start to ask some questions. You start wondering, why would people do this? Are they mentally ill? Are they intoxicated? Is it just a glorious absence of sophistication? What could possibly explain that? Or a time where I was actually in the restroom at Walmart and a gentleman came in beside me at the urinal right beside me and started yelling at his urinal and screaming at it while he was using it. Again, why would someone do this? Did he want to get rid of me? Because it worked. I got out of there. Was he mentally ill? Was he intoxicated? How can we explain these kinds of behaviors? And when we see things happening in cities that we don't see happening in rural areas, we start asking the same kind of questions. Why? Why is the crime rate higher? Why are people more dangerous? Why are cities more diverse? And we start trying to attribute. Before I do that, I have something that I want to show you, and I hope this works. Now, I have some images, and I'll just go through some of these, of people at Walmart, peopleatwalmart.com. It's fun to look at some of these and, again, try to attribute, why would people wear what they wear, do what they do? What can we attribute these behaviors to? Now, these pictures aren't too bad. But why would someone bring a monkey to Walmart? What can we attribute that behavior to? Again, what can we attribute this behavior to? Confusion? Do they think they're wearing leggings or stretch pants? Because they don't look like anything but pantyhose to me. Life is short, pray hard. What would Jesus do? He might pull his pants up. Maybe. What do we attribute this to? Did he just break out of the mental ward? Is it Halloween? Maybe it's a costume? I don't know. So you can go through and ask yourself why people would dress the way they dress or act the way they act in public. And again, we can come or drive the kind of cars they drive. That's interesting. As is that. So again, I'll just kind of sift through some of these here. And yes, we are from West Virginia. So again, the confusion perhaps between pantyhose and leggings, I don't know. Maybe these people haven't heard of a belt, I don't know. I've heard of the no shirt, no shoes policy. I think we need a policy for this too. I don't know what it would be, but I think we need a policy. So again, we try to attribute behaviors to various things in cities and outside of cities. Now, one of the last things I want to talk about is the correspondence bias. This is our tendency to attribute behavior to internal causes to a greater extent than is actually justified. So we have a tendency to assume that people do things for internal reasons. They're choosing to do things. And we tend to ignore the external pressures that may be causing people to do things. Let me give you a couple of examples. A guy in a red sports car cut me off in traffic. I was traveling through a city that will remain nameless, and this guy in a red sports car literally ran me off the road. Almost killed me. I mean, it was really scary. And a couple hours later, it was just dumb luck. I pulled over to a gas station, and there was this guy in this car. It was the same guy. I couldn't believe it. So I have this idea in my mind of people in cities just being jerks, being in a hurry, being impatient, being rude. Those are all internal attributions. That's the correspondence bias. So I assumed he was choosing to drive this way. So I confronted him, and he said, "Look, no, I'm sorry. You probably didn't see, but I had my son in the back of the car. He was critically injured, or so I thought, and I was trying to get him to the hospital." So that felt pretty bad. Assuming his story was true, that was an external, not an internal reason for running me off the road. He couldn't control the fact that his son was in a life-threatening accident and that he had to get him to the hospital. It was a matter of life or death. Someone gets in front of you at line at Walmart. You assume that they're being rude or impatient, and you probably have some choice words for them. Have you ever accidentally got in front of someone in line? I certainly did that one time, and I was yelled at and cursed at, and told about it, but it was simply an accident. I was distracted. I was in line. Someone spoke my name. I turned around to respond because I wanted to be polite. Chat for a few seconds, and I got back in line where I thought I was supposed to be, but I actually got in front of this woman and didn't realize it until it was too late. There was a woman who I tried to speak to, the last example here. Six or seven times I would be walking outside, and I would say, "Hi, how are you?" You know, and I would try to engage her in conversation, and she wouldn't even look at me. She wouldn't say anything to me, and she was like 3 feet from me. So I couldn't figure out why she was so rude. Again, an internal attribution. I was falling victim to the correspondence bias. She was, as it turns out, was blind and deaf. And that's why she wasn't speaking to me. She couldn't see me or hear me. And I almost said something to her. And before I did, someone pulled me to the side and explained to me that she was blind and deaf. So again, those are external reasons, not internal reasons, why she wasn't speaking to me. But we tend to go with internal reasons, especially in cities, when someone cuts us off or someone runs over top of us. We think that they're being rude, but maybe it's the external pressure exerted on these people by the city itself and by how the city forces people to be in a hurry or forces people to be more impersonal. And we're going to call that the end of the second part and the last part for the supplementary lecture on urban sociology, chapter 3. Thank you.